moment we're at the crossroads for making change about this disease. Because I think we do have an unrecognised endemic disease. We don't have an epidemic, we have an endemic disease here. Some people have applied to say disease, some people have applied here as an endemic Australia. And it's impacting thousands of lives, and I suspect we have no idea of the numbers. And that's really important, because if we don't know that how many people we're treating, we've got no idea how big this disease is and what it looks like. The problem, as Sharon's pointed out, medical denialism is a huge problem in Australia. And I understand why infectious diseases specialists would not like to take a new Lyme patient on, because it takes, every time I see new patients, it's 3 hours, every patient. And I've seen 4,000 of these patients with chronic fatigue. Some have been And then there's mistreatment as a result of that process. So if you haven't, you're denying the diseases here, and you won't make the diagnosis, you won't join the dots. So we need a political and a medical change of thought. As I said earlier, maybe we need to go 180 degrees and have a different viewpoint. So overseas and around the world, vector-borne disease is one of the fastest growing diseases in the world. It's highly transmissible, and exactly in Connecticut, you get a tick bite if you're in Black Forest, you're likely you may contract Lyme disease or the European version. In Australia, I don't think that happens. I think it's very rare that people get tick bites and get Borrelia or these co-infections, considering the number of people get tick bites, but there's definitely people who appear to get it. Just because we haven't found it in ticks doesn't mean it's not in people. We have a whole range of ticks that bite people that could carry these diseases, and unless we study a lot more ticks, probably multiples of what we've already done, we're not going to find these organisms as yet. Now, I'm the president of ACIDS. I set this up with some other doctors. There's 60 doctors in ACIDS, and there's infectious diseases specialists, physicians, pediatricians, and GPs who are interested in vector-borne disease and what that means. We've treated about 4,000 patients in the last 6 years. 1,500 patients currently, up to the census a few days ago, because we have meetings every month. We share journals, we share patients, we talk to each other, we have webinars. We're just quietly working away, learning the science. And this is going to cost an enormous amount of money for public health and the governments of Australia, because if there is an avalanche of patients who aren't treated, aren't diagnosed, we're going to have a large population of people who are being ignored because it's a bit difficult, and that's going to cost a lot of money. So, my history goes back a long way. I graduated in 78, but I worked in Papua New Guinea. I had a particular interest in TB and leprosy. I trained as an intensive care physician, got out of that, did isolated rural general practice, but I was working in Bellingen. And in 1983, I had patients coming in, had a large population of gay people. They were traveling to the bathhouses in San Francisco, and I started to see AIDS. And these people would have unusual infections, they would get very ill, and some of them would die. And then eventually, we got a diagnosis. We found a virus, we set up clinics, we started telling people there was an illness out there. Remember the bowling ball, the Grim Reaper. We started to see there was an illness out there, and by the mid-90s, that epidemic had settled. We had clinics, we had a diagnosis, we had a treatment protocol, we had companies paying money for research and developing treatment. So, after I finished working with, I actually got into treating HIV patients, and I lost over 100 of my patients died from this illness. So I really was involved, and I first had to hear that David Cooper passed away because we shared a lot of patients together. From 1997, I just made a conscious decision that I wanted to treat complex and chronic disorders, particularly chronic fatigue syndrome in children and young adults, because I started to see they were a very neglected group. And every one of these patients has got a history. As Sharon says, they might have seen 10 or 15, 20 doctors prior to coming to my clinic. And I decided I wanted to learn about this disease. So I spent the last 20 years learning about these diseases. And in 2014, I set up the group ACIDS with some other GPs. We've got about 60 doctors in our group. And as I said, we meet regularly and share papers or whatever. So this vector-borne disease that we think we may have in Australia that's overseas. Now, if you're in America, these are all American patients. Now, all these patients, supposedly, because we've got them from the internet, have been diagnosed with Lyme disease, that's malaria, infection, everything with Lyme disease. Because all those patients have a variant of that rash. This patient is from Victoria. He was sick, saw his GP, had a chick by in the middle, a rash that looks very similar. Patient had fever, swollen glands, he had a flu-like illness. The GP rang, he sent him a photo, and I said, put him on some doxycycline, the patient will be better. Serology was negative, you know, doesn't develop serology reaction because the organism is still in the immune response. And I think that's why the pathology we carry is flawed. So when I'm in a fortunate position because I only have referrals. I don't take new patients. So all the patients I see are referred to me by other specialists, and I'm a GP, and other GPs. And I've probably seen 700 or 800 patients that I think may have a vector-borne illness. And they present to me with these histories: chronic fatigue syndrome, fatigue, cognitive dysfunction, body pain, brain fog, headache. Classic chronic fatigue syndrome, no diagnosis, fibromyalgia. The difference between fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue, they have fatigue but the pain is not, and they have sleep disturbance. Autoimmune disease. How many times do we see a rheumatoid arthritis patient, big swollen joints, and they say, oh yeah, I had a tick bite, maybe, don't know about that. But all their tests for rheumatoid are negative. We call them seronegative rheumatoid. Well, I've been taking specimens out of their joints and sending it off for PCR. Talk a little bit about that later, and they were positive for this condition. Some of these patients had travelled overseas, they were all Australian patients. Multiple sclerosis, but it's atypical. So I'm not saying all these diseases out there in our world of medicine. This is just a few patients who fall through the gaps. Are atypical, but multiple sclerosis. I had a patient in this week, and shared with Professor Bernie Hudson. He sent it to me to see if I could help her. She's doing really well, but she was unable, came in a wheelchair. She's now in recovery. Now, does she have MS? But she had some serology, some pathology suggesting she had an AOC-acquired Lyme-like illness, which contracted in Spain. But the presentation was multiple sclerosis. ALS, paralyzed twitches, fasciculations, death. And I have several patients with this that I have evidence that they suggest to me that they may have started this with a disease. Parkinson's disease. People get ticked by it and suddenly they develop a tremor within weeks. And there's a little enclave, a dangerous place in Sydney called Turramurra. Pembroke survives, but I see patients in their 20s with Parkinson's disease following a tick bite. And that's really concerning. But, and we don't necessarily have positive serology, but that's a concern. Alzheimer's disease. There's a research done in Switzerland which shows multiple patients who've had Alzheimer's and died have borrelia in the plaques, in the amyloid plaques of their brain. Now I read these papers all the time, I read as much as I can. That's quite scary, as Alzheimer's, I'm sure it's a select group, maybe there's a whole range of these ticks or bugs that bite people, make people sick, but if you're getting Alzheimer's from a bacterial infection which you can treat, that's a concern. Chronic pain syndrome. People come in, they're racked with pain. They look okay, but they tell you that they can't cope with life, they've beta burden, they've got neuropathy. Visceral fibromyalgia is got pain in their chest pain, and you can't find anything wrong with them. And some of these patients have history of vector bites, and some of them have evidence they may have a vector-borne illness. Autistic spectrum disorder, not the classic 18-month-old child who looks like they're autistic. 8 or 9 year-old normal kids get a tick bite, and suddenly they can't have a conversation, they're emotionally detached, they develop physical symptoms, they are quite ill. So these patients are common in my practice. I have multiple of them. They're referred by other doctors who think they could have this. And lots of them, we're talking about testing. I think testing is one of the biggest problems we have in Australia, because I don't think the testing is really suitable on anyone. A negative test doesn't mean you don't have the disease. I just don't think tests are appropriate. The two-tiered test might be good for America. It doesn't work here because I don't think we have Lyme disease. You may well have a borreliosis infection. You may well have Lyme-like bugs, but I suspect they're a different type of borrelia, probably with absent fever. Polymerase chain reaction test, ELISA test. I think ELISA test, these tests that CDC in America suggest, these are just screening tests for surveillance purposes. It's not useful. They're useful if they're positive, maybe. they're not useful if they're negative. We don't actually help us with why these patients are sick. And I totally agree with Lindley. Now, this is a dilemma. How do we diagnose this? But Western blot, sure, you might only have 3 brown bands. In Scotland, that's the Maven criteria. That's positive. In America, you need 5 bands. Doesn't make sense. And Australian patients don't have any bands. So do they actually have this illness or not? So because of that, these are just a few of the bugs that you can get in the ticks. I think in Australian ticks, we'll probably find a relapsing fever like that one echidna that Peter Irwin found in one organism of the Borrelia, relapsing fever, but the rickettsias, but rhabdomyosis, anaplasmosis. I'm sure the bees is here. We had a patient die at Canberra Hospital, never left Australia. Doxelia, P. fever, mycoplasmosis. So all those things are potential pathogens. And I think rickettsias and Bartonella are far more common than Borrelia in Australian patients from ticks. And I definitely use Stephen Graves. Stephen and I have done thousands of tests together. We've been talking to each other over the years. And I find his tests very useful, because often I will find they've got evidence that they've got Bartonella, rickettsial infections, which are chronic, and they've got symptoms supporting that diagnosis. Not necessarily really, but definitely some of them have Borrelia. And the whole problem of testing and NAHA approved in overseas labs, if we were to use one lab to make this diagnosis, we'd make an error. Often when these patients come to me, they have 5 or 6 labs of inflammation. And sometimes it's collegial. There is a relationship in the actual test with the history, with the clinical setting, which suggests to me that they have this infection. So if you rely on one lab, and you could do too many cycles on PCR, totally right, I think you'll find false positives. But I think false negatives are a big problem. And in other words, the pathology isn't good enough. So I've been talking to a few colleagues, and we want to do something to correct that. So I'm just announcing today that we are actually setting up with a couple of colleagues, Professor Vernon Hudson from Lord Offshore Hospital, Professor Gilles Guillemont, the head of neuroscience at Macquarie Uni, and Professor Ed Holmes. We're actually setting up a research centre for vector-borne disease. I'll go through what that is in a minute. We support the concept of the multidisciplinary clinic, because you're totally right. GPs can't manage this. What do? I've got 1,000 people in that group of doctors in the waiting list. What are we supposed to do? They take 3 hours each, and then you're going to see them every month for a couple of years. Develop the best practice vector-borne disease guidelines. So we, instead of quibbling about is it here, is it not, what's the best treatment, let's talk to the world and see what the world's doing, and then have a collaboration with the rest of the world. That's going to take a mindset change that we've actually got this disease here, because most of our patients, lots of our patients got this overseas anyway. So why wouldn't they have it? And there is a chronic form. It's not just an acute form. Because if you have an acute form and you've got a population of doctors and they have to treat, we won't get the chronic form. So this research centre, this is a little mnemonic with all this. So it's basically, the concept is we want to have a biobank. We collect samples from lots of patients and we take a questionnaire. So we've got a questionnaire. So we do a questionnaire on patients. I'll talk about how they're referred. We'll take blood and urine from these patients, maybe skin biopsies if they've got skin lesions, and they will go to this research unit. And Professor Gilles Guillemont is going to look at biomarkers. He's going to try and find something that's in these patients that's different to other patients. So if we create this is really useful. Ed Holmes at Sydney Uni is going to look at the genomics of the right way to go. We've got to stop this business of trying to PCR things that are really hard to find and we're not sure. Genomics will help sort this out so we find bacteria, virus, and other, if they're actually going to be there in those samples. We need a entomologist, someone to look at the ticks from those areas where those people got sick, because maybe we're just looking at the wrong ticks. And then a mechanism of association with inflammation and neuromodulation, because these people are immuno-altered. I'm not convinced they're immunosuppressed. Often, I measure the cytokine levels, I'm measuring signs of inflammatory change other than normal pathology, and they've got massive inflammation. They've got a massive turmoil of their immune system, which is why they develop autoimmune diseases. But we need this network of specialists. We've talked about New South Wales, because this is for a New South Wales setting. We hope to start with 1,000 patients. I don't think it'll take very long to get 1,000 patients, maybe 2 or 3 weeks. Because we can have that many in New South Wales, we could refer to get these tests done. and hopefully if I put it out there, we can find some people who haven't been treated or mistreated or whatever. But we need a whole range of specialists who are interested in urology, pain, rheumatology, gastroenterology, pediatrics, and of course psychiatrists and cardiologists. It's interesting, a lot of my referrals come from top cardiologists who say, Richard, I think this person's got vector-borne disease and they've got a myocarditis or a pericarditis. We don't know what, they're not getting better with the treatment. Do you think they may have one of these infections? And some of them actually do. And that's the support that I'm getting from down at the reference laboratory in Victoria. And often we find a rickettsial, particularly Bartonella. Bartonella in Australia is particularly a bad infection for some of those patients. And I think a lot of the neuropathic pain patients have Bartonella. So it's really important that we actually, this multidisciplinary clinic thing is a fantastic idea. Every stage, because I can tell you, we're suffering GP fatigue, specialist fatigue, trying to take on all these patients. I've tried not to take new patients except referrals, because every one is 3 hours each time you see them every month, work out if you can treat them. And, you know, it's not just about antibiotics. I think there's a misinformation they're just throwing hollow antibiotics. Definitely some of the patients seem to have that, but that's not what we're doing. So if we have a clinic, it has to be patient-focused. You can't have a clinic that's doctor-focused and you have to, the patients have to fit into the doctors. These people are damaged, they're coming in their wheelchairs, they're coming out of their beds, they're disabled, they're frightened, they totally don't trust the medical profession because they've often seen 20 doctors who just abuse them. And that's basically true. For most patients, I say, you find you're safe. Appropriate safe environment with vulnerable patients. So you've got to think about the layout, just the architecture of the place. Quiet, warm, appropriate environments for sick people. And you know, if you said, I've got a clinic open, the wheelchairs will be lying under the door. And a multidisciplinary team approach, and I think that's essential. And who's in the team? The specialist doctors. And this is really important. If you're going to do this, we need specialists who've got the same collegiate thought process that these people have a genuine illness. And if we disprove they have a vector-borne illness, we still need a centre to look after the chronically ill. Because I mean, I think this is not just vector-borne disease, this is people with all sorts of other illnesses, particularly chronic fatigue syndrome, which is a very abandoned illness. There's only a few clinics even looking at this, but they're taking them all on. General practitioners, but these people have to train. They can't be just anyone off the street or anyone having surgery. You need to be trained in what these illnesses and how to do it. All the allied health people and psychosocial support. NDIS does not support chronic fatigue syndrome to any extent, and definitely wouldn't support vector-borne disease as a diagnosis to get support. It's hard enough to get a pension or any support. And most of the parents, or the loved one, whoever's looking after them, they all struggle emotionally, physically, and financially. Now, who are the patients referred from? Look, if we ask the GPs to refer the patients, we educate them. Obviously, emergency centres, lots of our patients with this illness go to the casualty, and self-referrals. We have questionnaires online and in-house, all ready to go. So Google something through MyGov or where this is ever going to be done. You fill in the questionnaire, you get a point system. We've got a number of protocols that we use at our clinic. Richard Horowitz has got a very good one. But whatever we need to do, we need to get the information about the patient. When you come in, Lindsay's correct. I mean, this is, you know, 2 or 3 hours of complexity and story and illness and emotion and whatever. When you take a history and do a clinical assessment, but it needs to be accurate. They need to be heard. You actually need to open your ears to these patients because they're profoundly unwell and they need to be heard. And they're terribly frightened. They're abandoned by this illness. This is a really serious problem. And then you need to do the general and specialised test. If you do a general pathology test on these patients, they will generally be negative unless they've got another illness. And definitely I find 10% of my patients don't have these illnesses. They have something else that's defined, although it just hasn't been looked at. They've got sarcoidosis or some other illness that's been missed, or their celiacs. I can't tell you how many patients I've seen with these illnesses actually have severe celiac disease with no gut symptoms. But they've got pain and they've got a whole lot of other fatigue and whatever, and turn out celiac. But that's the tip of the iceberg. Most of these patients very likely have a vector-borne disease. So we need to do the appropriate specialised pathology. Stephen Graves is making an attempt, but I think our biobank and network, the research unit we're going to set up, may be exemplary. We may be able to create the world's best practice for this. And if we don't find something, we don't find something. I think we've got to be scientific about what we're looking for. But to deny it's not there by the wrong test isn't helpful. So scans, I don't use many MRIs, they're useful. I like CT SPECT scans because it shows the hyperperfusion in the brain, the inflammatory response, and it actually corresponds with the symptoms that these patients have. Specific assessments, you need on transit search because they've got gastroparesis, severe slow transit constipation. Look at their, do a tilt table test because they've got POTS, they've got disordered problems. So they're very sick patients, and the biobank. So automatically, the patient comes in, GPs all know, specialists all know, occasionally, but it's urine straight to the biobank. So we've got a history, they go online, they fill in the form, they send something to the biobank, which we will analyse. And then the multidisciplinary team assessment. And I think that's essential. You can't treat this endemic illness singly. I've tried. I've got 7 or 8 doctors with me, psychologists. I've got a whole bank of specialists who support this group, and they are very helpful, but we are overwhelmed with the numbers that we see. We don't take new patients because we have trained us in trouble looking after the ones we've got.
2 minutes.
Yep, a couple of things. If you're going to treat these people, you need to treat the whole person. And you've got to have a long-term view. The average patient with these illnesses takes 2 to 5 years to get better, if you can get the better one. So you've got to think long-term. Supportive therapies and lifestyle management are very important. You've got to treat the comorbidities. You can't give patients treatment, whatever that may be, if they've got POTS or they're paralyzed gut or they're profoundly depressed or they're seizuring. They've got racked with pain. You've got to manage all that. Antibiotics are appropriate use. And I hope there's a better method than antibiotics for this. I think treating patients in the first instance at the first tick bite may reduce the numbers in Australia. We need to get a thought process out of that. And I have acids and spruce used to guidelines suggesting that's all we do. When a patient has a tick bite, they're sick, even if they don't have evidence, they get treated. 2 weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks, depending on their illness. So that would save all this long-term antibiotics, which some of my patients definitely I've seen have had. And with all the complications you'll find out. Other treatments, hypothermia, I won't go into these things, immunoglobulin, they're useful. Patients are streaming overseas to have these treatments. No doctor, no one's looking after them, they're just self-referring. So I've been to these clinics overseas to have a look and see what they're doing. And I've talked to the doctors running. They're very ethical doctors, I think they're helping the patients, but it's not the science isn't there. So but I've gone there, maybe we need people going over. Real education, long-term support. So we do need to have a long-term thought process around this other than just a clinic of treatment. But we need to rehab these people. So the government, I'm going to be very quick. First thing, recognise this illness is here. Doesn't matter if it's overseas or Australian acquired. Get the community aware that if you get bitten by a tick, it's a problem. Notification. We must notify this disease and chronic fatigue. We need to put it there so we get a number. If we've got a raw number, then we know how big this problem is. But because it's a multi-systemic disease, it's not notified, but it needs to be notified. Education of the medical profession, because the medical profession is totally not on board with this. It needs a total re-education process to think differently about this disease, show compassion. But if they've got a multidisciplinary clinic that they could go to, that would help. Most GPs have got a 5-minute window to see the patient. Now, making the tick-borne diseases notifiable will help build the risk profile of tick bites and allow the impact of such diseases to be better understood. Now this is from Giles Gillen, my colleague, who's setting up at the clinic. He runs a professor of neuroscience at Macquarie Clinic. Fantastic man. He's already developed some ideas about breast cancer and brain cancer, and I think he may well find a biomarker for these illnesses. So we're going to look. Now, my vision. So we're in a unique position in Australia. Because we haven't dealt with this very well, we can deal with it extremely well if we have that thought process. So we need to get out there in our medical, in government, and doctors and say, okay, let's take world best practice. Let's find out what everyone else is doing and institute it here. We need to have a leadership diagnosis of treatment, so sure research and understanding the biobank and whatever will help. Educate the community that ticks are dangerous. And if you get a tick bite and you're sick, you need to be treated. But also, if we do offer a treatment in the first instance, it's the gold standard. We need leadership, not denial, in from our leaders to tell what you do. You get a tick bite, GPs just ring me up. I get 5 or 6 calls a week. What do I do, Richard? They'll ring Bertie Hudson. Then I don't know how many. Most patients are afraid to ring their infectious disease colleagues. That's not a good thing. Australian government and the medical profession has the capacity to show that leadership. So hopefully out of today, 180 degree turn, think about this a bit differently. So the patients and the science and the doctors